Penguin Random House Audio presents Beaten Down, Worked Up: The Past, Present, and Future of American Labor by Stephen Greenhouse. Read for you by Fred Sanders. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Frederick Douglass. The only effective answer to organized greed is organized labor. Thomas R. Donohue, inauguration speech as AFL-CIO president, August 1, 1995, Chicago. Introduction. Like millions of workers, I was stewing about my pay. It was 1977, and after 18 months at my first newspaper job, I was earning $220 a week. Many of us reporters were putting in 50 to 60-hour weeks, often working from 1 p.m. to 1 a.m., researching and writing stories in the afternoon, covering town council and school board meetings in the evening, and then rushing back to the office to write stories about the evening's events. Putting in for overtime was frowned upon. It could hurt your chances of getting ahead or getting a beat you coveted. A few of us discussed what to do about the low pay, and we looked into unionizing. We contacted the newspaper guild, and we scheduled a dinner at a local restaurant one Friday night to discuss the idea with a union organizer. If my memory is correct, about 60 reporters, copy editors, and photographers had signed up to attend. That Friday afternoon, a notice appeared unexpectedly on the newsroom's bulletin board, announcing that the newspaper was giving nearly everyone a 20% raise. We were thrilled, even though the announcement drained away most of the interest in unionization. That big raise showed what a union, or the threat of a union, could accomplish. It was an era when unions were far stronger and companies were far more scared of them. Now, four decades later, labor unions are far weaker. The decline of unions and of worker bargaining power in general has taken a toll on our nation. It has contributed to many of the country's major problems: increased income inequality, wage stagnation, declining mobility, the high number of low-wage jobs, and the skewing of our politics in favor of corporations and wealthy campaign donors. Millions of Americans know little about what unions have achieved over American history, how the labor movement has played an important, often unsung role in making America the great nation it is today. Labor unions, and their ability to create a powerful collective voice for workers, played a huge role in building the world's largest, richest middle class. The success of American business, of course, played a major part as well, but it was unions' strikes and the millions of workers who took to the streets that pressured companies to share their profits more fairly after World War II. Unions also played a crucial role in achieving many things that most Americans now take for granted: the 8-hour workday, employer-backed health coverage, paid vacations, paid sick days, safe workplaces. Indeed, unions were the major force in ending sweatshops, making coal mines safer, and eliminating many of the worst, most dangerous working conditions in the United States. "Factory jobs didn't start as good jobs," one union leader told me. "They were shit jobs. People got killed all the time. Unionization caused them to change that." When the labor movement was robust, we as a nation moved toward greater economic and social justice. But with the union movement diminished, and with many billionaires and corporations seeking to cripple it further, we as a nation are moving toward more inequality and unfairness. In the following pages, I tell the history of labor unions and worker power in America, focusing on pivotal episodes that built the union movement and gave workers a true voice and true power that lifted wages and benefits for millions of Americans. I write of key labor leaders and landmark confrontations, huge, riveting dramas in their day, like the Women Workers' Uprising of the 20,000 of 1909-10, the Flint sit-down strike of 1936 to 37, and the Memphis sanitation worker strike of 1968. I also explore the downward arc of the union movement and of worker power, why this has been happening, and what it has meant for the nation. I explore the factors that have fueled this decline, including globalization, the rise of the atomized gig economy, and corporate America's war against labor unions. I devote several chapters to major episodes that badly set back labor, including the disastrous air traffic controller strike of 1981 and Scott Walker's crusade to cripple Wisconsin's government employee unions in 2011. As a result of these fights and forces, the United States now has the weakest labor movement of any advanced industrial nation. And that's a major reason why income inequality has grown worse in America than in any other industrialized nation. Finally, I write about several unusually successful modern-day labor efforts that signal a hopeful path for workers, a path to lift wages, increase worker power, and improve jobs, as well as workers' productivity and morale. I was the first journalist to write about the Fight for 15 when it was just getting started in 2012, and I take a close look at that fight, by many measures, the biggest, most successful labor effort in decades. I also examine the coalition of Immokalee workers, which has done an astonishing job transforming the once miserable jobs of tens of thousands of farm workers. I look at Kaiser Permanente's labor management partnership, probably the nation's best example of how management and workers cooperate closely to cut costs, boost efficiency, and improve service, morale, and wages. I also tell of the St. Paul Federation of Teachers, which has blazed a remarkable path, battling not just for teachers, but for students, the community, and greater social justice, as part of an innovative strategy known as bargaining for the common good. This is not a detailed, comprehensive history. For that, I recommend such excellent books as Labor in America, A History by Melvin Dubofsky and Joseph A. McCartan, State of the Union by Nelson Lichtenstein, and There is Power in a Union by Philip Dre. And because this is not a comprehensive history, I cannot do justice to some important groups and episodes in labor history, among them the Knights of Labor, the early railroad strikes, the Lawrence textile strike of 1912, the Wobblies, the general strikes in Minneapolis and San Francisco in 1934, and the Little Steel strike of 1937, in which 10 unarmed workers and supporters were killed in Chicago. I grew up in Massapequa, a part working class, part middle class town on Long Island, and I could see how unions helped many of the people living there. Firefighters, police officers, construction workers, teachers. My father was a high school teacher, and I saw how his union went a long way to provide teachers with good pay, health insurance, solid pensions, and important protections against retaliation and dismissal if they wanted to speak out, for instance, against the Vietnam War. My parents grew up during the Great Depression, when millions of struggling Americans poured into labor unions. I remember what my then 86-year-old mother told me during a phone conversation when I was in Wisconsin to cover Scott Walker's push to gut collective bargaining and cut public employees' health and pension benefits. She bemoaned the situation, saying, "When I was growing up, people used to say, 'Look at the good wages and benefits that people in a union have. I want to join a union.' Now people say, 'Look at the good wages and benefits that union members have. They're getting more than what I get. That's not fair. Let's take away some of what they have.'" Her comments captured an unfortunate loss of solidarity among Americans, as well as a lamentable impulse not to lift each other up, but to take away from other workers who might have it a little bit better. During my 19 years covering labor and workplace issues for the New York Times, I wrote about some amazing things unions did, like unionizing 5,200 immigrant janitors in Houston. That effort showed how unionization could be a boon for marginalized workers. It ultimately doubled the pay of those janitors, provided them with valuable protections against abusive bosses, and gave many of them and their families health coverage for the first time in their lives. I also wrote about the downside of labor unions, doing many stories about union corruption, about labor leaders embezzling money, taking bribes from men.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.